I'm Ann Dart.
I'm Tracy Stormy.
And I'm Kathy Knight.
And together we are...
It Was a Dark and Stormy Book Club.
A podcast for mystery lovers.
Welcome.
Welcome to the latest In Agatha's Footsteps. Today, we have an exciting interview with Anne Hillerman.
Anne Hillerman is delighted to continue the mystery series her father, the best-selling author Tony Hillerman, created beginning in 1970. Anne's debut novel, Spider-Woman's Daughter, followed the further adventures of the characters Tony Hillerman made famous, Jim Chee and Joe Leaphorn. The book also elevated a minor character, Bernadette Manuelito, to the role of crime solver. Bernie became the central protagonist in the reimagined series. Released by HarperCollins, Spider-Woman's Daughter received the Spur Award from Western Writers of America for Best First Novel. Four more mysteries followed, each becoming a New York Times bestseller. The newest book in the series, The Tale Teller, was set for release April 9th and features a plot that calls attention to the Navajo's Long Walk and the treaty that established what was to become the thriving Navajo Nation. Anne is also the author of the nonfiction book Tony Hillerman's Landscape, On the Road with Chee and Leaphorn, with her husband and photographer, Don Stroh. In collaboration with St. Martin's Press, she established the Tony Hillerman Prize for Best First Mystery Novel, set in the Southwest. She lives and works in Santa Fe with frequent trips to Navajo land. Welcome in.
Well, thank you. I'm delighted to have a chance to talk about my books and my career as a writer.
Well, wonderful. Your dad wrote 18 books in the series, and you've written 5. What drew you to continue your dad's work? And do you think it was just in your genes?
I think being a writer definitely was in my genes. Before I started writing fiction, I had been a journalist and I'd written 5 nonfiction books. What drew me to the series, there were really 2 things. First of all, my last nonfiction book was a book that I did with my husband, Don Strell. And it was about the places in Navajo land that my dad wrote about. And I went through all of his books and book by book found the real places where that scenery was so lovely that Jim Chee or Joe Leaphorn just had to pull off the road and, you know, watch the sunset or watch the rainbow. So that was one thing. His work was really fresh in my mind. And my dad died right before that book came out. So then my husband and I went on a book tour. This is a long answer to your question. It sort of speaks of my evolution as a writer. Way Don and I were on this book tour and we're talking about our book. And then, like you do on book tours, I would say, okay, does anybody have any questions? And inevitably someone would say, so are there going to be any more Jim Chee, Joe Leaphorn books? You know, did your dad have anything at the printer, anything almost ready to come out? And I would have to say, no, sorry, he didn't. And then the person who asked that question, they would say, oh, I'm heartbroken. I love those characters. They were like part of my family. So all the time that I'm kind of getting over the loss of my dad, I'm hearing people say how much they're missing his story. And at one point, it dawned on me that I was just like them, and I was really missing those stories, too. So that was part of what led me to take the leap and try my hand at fiction. And the other thing was, Dad had this character, a minor character, a woman police officer named Bernadette Manuelito. And I had always really liked her. And so I thought, it's just a shame for the series to end without Bernie having a chance to rise from being a girlfriend to being a full-fledged crime solver. Those were kind of the 2 joint elements that led me to write my first novel, Spider-Woman's Daughter.
Now, in your dad's books, Bernie starts out, as you said, as a very minor character. Why did you decide she was the one character in the book that to bring to the forefront?
I always always really liked her, and I thought that she had more potential than my dad had developed with her. I don't know. I was in his second to the last book, Skeleton Man. Bernie goes down to the Grand Canyon with Jim Chee and his buddy Cowboy Dashi, and the boys say, okay, honey, you wait here and we'll go down and solve the crime. But Bernie doesn't wait. She goes down. She finds a woman who's been kidnapped. She finds some stolen diamonds. She finds the bad guys. Basically, she has solved the crime. But then, because my dad loved those Jim Chee and Joe Leaphorn, there's a flash flood and Jim Chee rescues Bernie. After that, I thought, gee, it would have been so nice if she had actually been able to solve the crime. That incident really stuck in my mind when I was thinking of how I could take on the series and be true to the wonderful ground rules that my dad had laid out for it, but still do something that would give it my own voice. And so I thought of Bernie, and I thought she is just the ideal character for me to take and develop into something more than my dad had.
Well, do you see Bernie passing Jim Chee in the police department? And how do you think that would change their relationship?
Oh, that's a really good question. You know, I don't think so. Police departments kind of work like a lot of systems where seniority has its rewards. Jim Chee has been there much longer than Bernie, so I don't think that would happen. I could see her maybe getting a job with another agency, though, where they would be more on an equal level. I haven't gotten to that point yet in my book, so stay tuned.
Okay. It seems like most of the time, they're going in six different directions, so they don't get to see each other very much. It's like Bernie's over here and Jim Chee's in another city, and they kind of meet each other on the fly.
Yeah, they are both really busy. That is factually true of all of the officers who work on the Navajo Nation. They could use twice as many officers and they still would be understaffed. Yeah, they're busy. And then on top of that, Bernie has her mom and her sister who are always demanding her attention.
Now, you brilliantly tell about little known, at least to us, Caucasians.
Other than Native Americans.
Right. Traditions and history and legends that you put in your book so brilliantly. Do you feel the spirits kind of guide you as to what goes into what book?
I would say it's more research that guides me, but I do notice when I'm writing along, if I come to a step place and maybe I'll go out and take my dog for a walk or something. And sometimes when I come back, I think about my dad and I think, gee, Dad, if you were here, what advice would you give me? And sometimes having that thought kind of helps me move things along. Going back to your question about Navajo practices and beliefs, I do a lot of research. The Navajos are one of the tribes that's been written about probably more than any other tribe in the United States. So there's tons and tons of research on them. Besides that, I also have Navajo consultants who help me and try their best to keep me out of trouble. So those two things help me when I'm working on a story and say I'm trying to think, oh, say a family has had a son that has died. Would they then feel comfortable using that name for another child? In one of my books, I used that as a theme. Before I used it, I asked several of my Navajo consultants, and they said, well, it's not done much, but sure, people do that. So that made me feel reassured that I was getting it right.
Well, I loved in The Cave of Bones, I believe, you talked about the party for the first laugh for a baby. I just thought that was so sweet.
You know, I love that. I think that is so dear. It's kind of when, and I think all of us as moms know that, it's when your darling little blob starts to really show some personality when you see that first laugh and that first smile. So I think that's a wonderful thing to celebrate. And many Navajo people have wonderful senses of humor. The person who elicits that first smile from the baby is the person who has to pay for the party. So I think that's great.
That's wonderful.
Well, in the tale teller, piece of history that you mentioned really struck me. It was very interesting. It was about the postal inspector and how that was the very first federal agency. And I just thought,
Have you been holding on to that little piece of research and just waiting to have a place to insert it in one of your books?
I wish I could say yes, but actually not. That was a really interesting situation. You know, often nonprofit groups ask authors if they will donate the naming rights to one of their characters. And so that was how that lovely character got the name Jim Bean. Jim Bean had, and his wife Wanda, had bought me at an auction here in Santa Fe to benefit a group that provides art supplies for children. And then unfortunately, a few months after that, Mr. Bean died. So I thought, oh, I really want this character to be a man of substance and a good guy. So I was thinking, how could I kind of round him out so he was more than just a minor character? So I thought, well, of course he's going to be writing a book. And then from that idea, then I did a little research into postal inspectors. And that's where I came up with that little golden nugget that I was able to sneak into the tale teller.
Well, I love all the history you find. It's so interesting. It's one of the best things I find about reading your books.
Well, thank you. Part of the problem is knowing when to stop with that stuff. Reminding myself, people are reading this because they want to find out who done it. And as much as they may be interested in the history of postal inspectors, you know, you have to just put in enough to make them curious that so if they want to know more, they'll do their own research.
And that's another thing. You talk about the whodunit. That's something else that strikes me about your books is that you have like two or three mysteries going at
yes.
the same time. And in other books, they kind of wrap them up together, like each part of the mystery winds up being related to the other part. And your books don't do that. They are truly separate mysteries that you're solving. You know, it just struck me. And I thought, why and how and what inspires you to do that?
Well, I didn't really mean to do that. In my first book, Spider Woman's Daughter, basically Bernie and Chee are working together to solve the crime. And Joe Leaphorn is kind of out of commission in that book. So then on my second book was Rock with Wings. And I thought, oh, this is great. I'll just have Bernie and Chee solve a crime and I'll think of something for Leaphorn to do. And I worked on that book for about 2 months and it was just dreadful. I could barely read it myself. It was so awful. And so I thought, what is going on here? And finally, it dawned on me that Bernie had been a sidekick for, I think, 5 of my dad's books. And she was done. She did not want to be a sidekick. So I came up with a different crime for her to solve. Once I figured that out, then the book just really soared along. Ever since, that has kind of been the way that those books have gone. And I just blame it on her. Authors say that characters speak to them. And sometimes when characters don't speak to you, then you know you're really in trouble. So anyway, that was how that happened. When I started writing mysteries, I thought I would try to make it as easy on myself as possible, but it just didn't work out that way.
I can imagine it would make it harder to try to think up 2 or 3 mysteries to put into one book.
Now, Joe Leaphorn was seriously injured. Do you see him sort of phasing into retirement?
No, actually, he is the main crime solver in The Tale Teller. I was hesitant at first to bring him back. I think partly because he was the very first character that my dad created. And he's kind of a grouchy old guy, which my dad was not. But other than that, they have a lot of traits in common. I think I didn't feel really confident taking him on as a full-fledged detective until this new book. Once I started working with him, I really, really enjoyed it. So in answer to your question, I would say, if anything, readers may see more of Joe Leaphorn in the future. Now that Joe and I have made peace and all is well between us, I think he's going to come back and really be a wonderful character as he was in my dad's books.
Yes, I always looked forward to your dad's new books coming out, and now I look forward to yours when they come out.
Well, I'm curious about Joe and Louisa's relationship, because it seems in The Tale Teller especially that it's a little rocky right now.
Yeah, that's a good observation. And I think all of us who, and I think women particularly, who've been in the position of being a caretaker for someone that we're fond of and making decisions and making appointments and being the driver, and then that person gets better. And so the roles shift. And I think that transition is difficult. And that's part of what's happening with those two characters in The Tale Teller.
Okay. Well, I hope they mend their ways.
Well, you'll just have to stay tuned.
Oh, we will. We definitely will do that.
Yes.
So, well, speaking of that, are you working on the next book and when can we expect it? And do you have any upcoming events to share with us?
Oh, my goodness. Well, let me answer your question about the book I'm working on now. Yeah, my contract with HarperCollins says that I should have a new book to them by December of this year. And I have about 100 pages written. I don't know how many of those actually